Dear Principal, Simrit Kaur, faculty members, and my young friends, I am honored to be invited to deliver the 10th anniversary talk at the SRCC Business Conclave. The list of luminaries graduated from SRCC is testimony to this tremendous institution of learning. I salute your founder, the great educationist and industrialist, late Sir Lala Sri Ram, for his contribution that helped lay the foundation of a self-reliant and industrialized India. His leadership in forming institutions like CII and FICCI are stellar examples of his vision of modern India. My young friends, the very fact you have the privilege to be students at SRCC is a reflection of your capabilities. This must be used to help build a resurgent India. Your faculty at the SRCC is outstanding, and it is they who make SRCC such an exemplary institution. Their contributions make for future leaders, and you are indeed some of the best talent our nation has. At the next 30-35 minutes, my intent is to accomplish two things. First, paint the picture of the incredible opportunity ahead of you. Second, talk about my personal journey. Many of you know, I rarely speak at external forums. In fact, this is my third invitation to this conclave. The reason I have hesitated to come and speak in the past is because I question if I could truly excite a set of intelligent and ambitious students like you. However, given the scale of the opportunities that lie ahead of our nation, I decided to come this time, hoping that if my story could set an example for even a handful of you, I would live satisfied that I had some impact. India now stands on the cusp of explosive growth that, barring US and China, no nation in modern history has witnessed. And you, my young friends, are right at the start of this race. With our GDP growth rates of over 7%, it is anticipated that India will become the world's third largest economy by 2030 and second largest by 2050. In 2050, most of you will still be in the early 50s and at the peak of your career. My friends, you are all in the golden era of India. Earlier this week, I returned from the World Economic Forum in Davos, where our Honorable Prime Minister, Shri Modi ji, delivered the opening address to a packed auditorium of over 3,000 of the world's most influential political, financial and business leaders. The excitement about the reforms in India was palpable. It was evident that over the past few years, there has been a dramatic progress in positioning India as a nation integrated into the global economy, a nation flexing its power and building key strategic alliances, and a nation that is firm yet restrained and extending a helping hand to those in need. Also, over the past few years, India has doubled down on a strategic partnership with the US. It has formed an alliance of immense significance with Australia and Japan, expanded economic ties with Southeast Asia, Africa and the Persian Gulf nation, and invested in the stability of Afghanistan as its second largest bilateral donor. India's position recently took yet another big jump when it took the lead to form the Global Solar Alliance and signed the groundbreaking Paris Accord. Yet another testimony of India's success was its 30-point jump in the ease of doing business ranking in the World Bank's 2018 report. Over the past few years, there have been four game-changing policies introduced which will drive foundational changes across India. The implementation of the GST, while still to be streamlined, will unify internal markets and become the catalyst for the GDP growth. Aadhaar is another remarkable initiative, getting 1.3 billion people on one common identification platform is a game changer for both tax collection and direct benefit distributions. It will transform the way government manages its subsidies and budget. The Jan Dhan Yojana has already led over 31 crore bank accounts being opened in a period of just 3 years. To date, it has yielded a staggering rupees 73,000 crores of deposits. And the Digital India revolution is on the track to ensure over 100 crores of our fellow countrymen have a mobile device in their hands by 2020, and over 50 crore internet users come online, thereby enabling a technology revolution of unprecedented scale. The combination of these initiatives will change India in a ways hard to imagine. It will unlock the bottom of the pyramid and lay the platform for expanding the middle class and setting off decades of a strong growth. And my young friends, you will be the biggest beneficiaries. However, all this is not to say we do not have hurdles to overcome. We are faced with a deepening income inequality. The challenge with the income security of our farmers, a problem with a job growth, a sustainability challenge, and increase geostrategic polarization. Therefore, what is being done is the dismantling of an old structure and its replacement by a new modern economic structure. What is being done is the repositioning of India in a new global order where we have a seat on every essential table. And what is being done is to take the single largest mass of humanity and transform 1.3 billion lives. None of this will happen overnight. It will probably get harder before it gets easier. But every single one of the challenges are a massive business opportunity for the young entrepreneurs amongst you. Our nation's advantage is we have the two critical levers, GDP growth and youth on our side, a unique position for us to exploit. Now let me talk about my personal journey that is tightly interwoven with the India growth story. I also hope, embedded with this story, you found some nuggets that inspire you to do your part to become an entrepreneur and work to build a greater India. I was 16 years of age when I left studies. I was a good student, but because of my family circumstances, I had to drop out of school. I left home having learned two core values from my father. First, commitment to the promises you make to yourself, and commitment to the promises you make to others. Both of these have to be in absolutely harmony. Second, avoid overanalysis of situations and have the courage to make quick decisions based on your natural instincts. I have followed both this value in every action I have taken. Having left studies, I moved to Mumbai in 1978, landing in Mumbai with nothing in my pockets was exciting as well as daunting. I wanted to be an entrepreneur, and I had the raw optimism of a 16-year-old boy. My first step in my entrepreneurial journey was learning to assort and do the valuation of diamonds. In less than 3 years, I had started my own diamond trading brokerage. I still remember my first trade with a Japanese buyer and my commission of rupees 10,000. I felt terrific that I had created this opportunity by myself, and for a teenager, there could not have been a greater confidence booster to get started. My young friends, an essential part of my learning throughout my career is that everyone gets opportunity in their life. So will you. However, the two questions you will need to answer are, can you connect the dots early enough to recognize the opportunity coming at you? And then, do you have courage to relentlessly chase it down? Let me elaborate how essential these two principles have been to me. It was 1984. Sri Rajiv Gandhi had come to power, and his enthusiasm as a young prime minister represented the new face of India, open to economic liberalizations. A slew of reforms were announced, and several raw materials controlled by the state trading corporations become permissible to be imported under the open general license. This was an opportunity I acted on instantly to start my import business, which in turn laid the foundation for the global trading business I was to build. The late 80s and early 90s were difficult years for India. The challenge of depleting foreign exchange reserves led to the government providing additional export incentives in 1989. Here again, I saw an opportunity to move quickly and establish a global trading house dealing in polymers, metals, textiles, and agro products. We grew so rapidly that within 2 years, we had become the largest trading house in the country, overtaking long-established market leaders. The year 1990-1991 saw one of the worst financial crises. India's reserves were down to less than $1 billion. It was at this time that Sri P.V. Narasimha Rao became the Prime Minister. Within weeks of coming to power, he and his Finance Minister Sri Manmohan Singh Ji announced a series of decisions, including a dramatic depreciation of the rupees to boost exports and increase India's foreign exchange reserves. India will remember these two leaders as the ones primarily responsible for the real start of liberalization and privatization of the Indian economy. Thereafter, in 1994, we executed on our first IPO. While the IPO was successful, it opened my eyes to another opportunity. As just a trading company with no assets, the dependence largely on my personal, individual entrepreneurial skills would limit the value of the company in the eyes of the investors. We therefore would need to build an asset base within the company. As the country's largest trading house, we are already using the port facilities across the country. Because of heavy congestion at the different ports, I was getting increasingly frustrated with the expensive damages I was paying, as well as my challenge in delivering timely shipments to my customers. I had therefore started seeking an opportunity to expand into the port business. In the mid-90s, as the central government realized that the quickest way to build the much-needed national infrastructure was through a far more aggressive push through the public-private partnership mode. In line with this central government policy, the government of Gujarat in 1995 came out with its port policy under the PPP mode. This is when we immediately decided to build a port at Mundra, at that time just a small village in Kutch. Keep in mind, we had no experience. We had never laid a brick before. All that we had was raw enthusiasm. All that we had was a belief in ourselves. The rest is the history. Mundra is now India's largest commercial port with a 40 kilometer of waterfront and is the single largest cargo gateway into India, having surpassed all other private and major ports in just 15 years. This was followed by our entry into the energy segment. Due to an acute shortage of power, the government of India amended the Electricity Act in 2003 and enacted the rules in 2006. This was our opportunity to make an immediate entry into the power generation business. No different from the ports, we knew nothing about power generations. However, what started as a plan for a 660 megawatt unit to supply power to our SEZ rapidly expanded to 11,000 megawatt of capacity within a short span of 6 years. In the same manner, we moved into power transmission business in the year 2012 and 13, and recently further extended our reach into the power distribution through the proposed acquisitions of Reliance Infra Mumbai distribution business. My young friends, less than a decade, we were largely known as a trading house and a one-pot company. Today, we are the country's largest ports and logistics business, largest private thermal power business, largest private transmission business, largest renewable energy business, largest coal trading business, largest mining business, and largest agro business, all in less than 10 years. Along this journey, we also built the world's largest thermal power plant site within the private sector, the world's largest import coal terminal, and the world's largest single location solar generation farm. Behind each one of these are inspirational stories of guts and sacrifices people have made to make all this happen. We also created significant shareholder value. An investor owning one share of Adani Enterprise at its 1994 IPO price of ₹150 would today be holding a shares worth about ₹1 lakh across Adani Enterprise, Adani Ports, Adani Power, and Adani Transmission. This translates to a return of over 650 times in less than 25 years. My young friends, many consider us to be a disruptive company. The fact is, over the past 20 years, India has continued to transform and open up several disruptive opportunities for many entrepreneurs. Infrastructure in a developing economy has an unlimited potential, and therefore, several of India's successful entrepreneurs have come from the space of energy, telecom, airports, seaports, and highways, which have all been sectored that benefited from the government's reforms since the start of our journey in late 1990s. My young friends, let me now elaborate on some of my fundamental learnings that I hope will be useful to you. First, have a personal purpose that drives you. It is said in the Gita, it is better to live your own destiny imperfectly than to live an imitation of somebody else's life with perfections. Purpose is identified as something that you see as your destiny 10, 20, or 30 years from now. In my case, the purpose that drives me is that of a nation building. Every infrastructure opportunity I have created is associated within this purpose. Since the mid-90s, I have wanted us to be a company that changed the perception of India from being infrastructure deficit to being home of the world's most impressive infrastructures. All the way from the pit to the plug, integrating mining to ports to logistics to power generation to power transmission and now power distributions. We have tried to make a difference to several of the critical sectors that our nation needs to build. Whether it is a port in Mundra or solar plant in Kamuti, that becomes showcase for the National Geographic Channel. We have tried to build world-class facilities India can be proud of. It is my power of purpose that keeps alive my will to win. Second, never let criticism derail your promise or purpose. US President Roosevelt once said, "It is not the critic who counts, nor the person who points out how the strong stumble. Credit belongs to the person who is fighting in the battlefield. The man whose face is marred by sweat and blood. The man will know in the end a towering victory, or if he fails while daring greatly." These words define the Adani Group. Let me elaborate. Our journey in thermal power and coal mining has often come under criticism by many outside India that believe India should give up on coal. We have lined up $15 billion investment in a greenfield venture in Australia to mine and transport coal that would replace a part of the poorer quality domestic coal we burn in India. This is the largest overseas greenfield investment ever planned by any Indian company. This project is intended to provide energy security to those in 18,000 villages in India that have no access to electricity, and in this process also be a significant job creation platform within Australia. However, in recent years, our project has faced intense resistance, abetted by some international NGOs and competitors who have turned to vicious personal attacks and used the press to their advantage. I will be the first to agree that global warming is a challenge we have to tackle, and a cleaner energy is critical. However, it is possible to believe in both coal as well as renewables. The fact is that India is one of the lowest emitters of carbon dioxide on a per capita basis. The fact is that we have 300 million of our fellow Indian citizens that lack access of power. The fact is that renewable energy technologies are not currently ready to provide uninterrupted baseload power. The fact is that it is our responsibility to get electricity to the Indian child who needs to light that single bulb to educate himself. And the fact that you and I cannot sit on the sidelines and watch this happen and take no action. What the critics don't mention, the fact that we are aggressively pursuing renewable energy. What the critics don't mention is that in a span of 2 years, we have become the country's largest renewable power player. And what the critics don't mention that are a feature as one of the top 15 renewable players in the world. Therefore, don't let criticism slow you in pursuit of your purpose. Learn from criticism that are constructive and grow stronger from ones that are not. Importantly, never hold grudge against those who criticize. Accept it as a way of life that will make you more resilient to face the future. Third and final, keep learning. I have realized over the years that leadership and learning are inseparable. If you want to recognize opportunity, you cannot afford to stop learning. In today's world, the rate at which science, technology, economics, and geopolitics is merging, the only way you stay on top of this by ensuring you are continuously learning. Even today, I try to spend a couple of hours reading every day, listening to people from a sectors that I know little about, making a couple of trips a year to Silicon Valley to see how game-changing technologies are impacting every facet of our life, and understanding how material science is redefining the way we produce energy. All this allow me to paint for myself the larger picture about where the next set of opportunity will be created. Therefore, develop a passion for learning. This is the only way you never cease to grow. My young friends, we live in a blessed country. You are at a point of time where the future of our nation is full of incredible growth opportunities. If I, against all odds, made it as an entrepreneur, there is no reason why there cannot be 1,000 greater entrepreneurs amongst you. Keep in mind that for every one of you here, there is 1 million out there who are less fortunate. Therefore, whatever you do it keeping your greater purpose in mind. Do it for your parents who have invested their life in you. Do it for your teachers who have selflessly worked for your success. And do it for that child who does not have the privilege of studying in a college like you. My young friends, I wish you the best. May all your aspirations come true, and may you take our nation, India, to great heights. Thank you. Jai Hind.